away underneath leaves. His clothes were torn apart. He was withered away. He was so skinny. There was a disease in his skin. And he was extremely sick. They thought that he was dying. So then they grabbed him. And as soon as Thalaba saw them, as though terror had happened to him, as if the angel of death came to him, he tried to struggle and run away, but they chased him and caught him. And then they grabbed him. And he said, "Please, please, don't take me to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Don't take me to him. Don't take me to him. I'm too scared." They said, "What is wrong with you? Take a hold of yourself, ya Thalaba." He said, "Please don't take me to him. I know what you are. I know why you are taking me to him. Allah has sent a verse down concerning me, hasn't he? He's sent a verse down concerning me, hasn't he?" He said, "Ya Thalaba, we don't know why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is asking for you. Please come with us." He said, "Yes, I know why. I know why." They said, "Wallahi, we have to take you to him. It is a commandment from the Prophet." And so they dragged him on his feet towards the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And they placed him in his house. And they told him, "Thalaba is at his home." So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came to him. And he kneeled down and kissed him on his forehead. And he said to him, "Ya Thalaba, what is wrong?" And he said, "Ya Rasulullah, are you hiding it from me?" He said, "What am I hiding?" He said, "Allah has sent down the verse concerning me that I am one of the hypocrites, hasn't he?" The Prophet ﷺ looked at him and he was crying. And the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "No, Ya Thalaba, Allah has not sent anything in your cause." And then he said, "I am going to be punished, Ya Rasulullah." And then the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Ya Thalaba, mimmada takhaf? What are you fearing?" And he said, "I fear that Allah is going to place me into the lowest place of hellfire. I did a great sin, Ya Rasulullah." And then the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Atakhafu min ghadabillah? Are you fearing the anger of Allah?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Walakinna al-mu'mana yarju." A mu'min also has another belief, and that is hope. "Mada tarju ya Thalaba?" What do you hope for? What do you wish for? What do you yearn for? And he said, "Inni arju rahmat Allah." I hope for the mercy of Allah and His forgiveness. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, "Fas'al Allah bima tarju." Then ask Allah with that which you are hoping for. "Wa ij'al adh-dhanna billahi hasan." And make your assumption about Allah good. You will find it. And then he made a dua. And the Prophet ﷺ read on his head and made a dua for him. Then all of a sudden, Thalaba said, "Ya Rasulullah, I feel as though there are thousands of ants crawling on my body." He said to him, "Awatajidu thalika ya Thalaba? Can you really feel that?" And he said, "Yes, Ya Rasulullah. And I'm about to go unconscious." And then the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Innahu al-mawtu qad nazala bika ya Thalaba. Faqul la ilaha illallah." It is death. It is now come and struck on you. You are dying, Ya Thalaba. So say La ilaha illallah. And then Thalaba began to repeat those words. He said, "Say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah." And he repeated those words until finally his soul escaped from his body. He was forgiven. But because, my dear brothers and sisters, he used the hope that he had with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he desired paradise. So Allah forgave him. Just like those whom Allah mentioned in the Quran when they had three loaves of bread. And then a poor person came and knocked on their door. And he said to him, "Miskeen, miskeen, miskeen, I'm a poor man." So they brought out their piece of loaf and gave it to him. And then the second day, their door knocked. And then he said, "Yateem, yateem, yateem, an orphan, an orphan." And so they gave him that second loaf of bread. And then the third man came a second day and knocked on their door. And he said, "Asir, asir, asir, a captive, a captive." They said, "Here's a loaf of bread." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا فوقاهم الله شر ذلك اليوم ولقاهم نظرة وسرورا وجزاهم بما صبروا جنة وحريرا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and they feed their wealth
out of love for Allah and desire for Jannah. An asir, a captive, and a poor person, and an orphan. And they would say to them, we are feeding you, not wanting thanks or any reward from you. We seek the pleasure of Allah, and we fear a day that will come to us on the Day of Judgment. Allah says, فَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ. And so Allah saved them from the bad misfits of that day. وَجَزَاهُمْ. And He rewarded them بِمَا صَبَرُوا, with that which they had been patient for. Naam, Jannah requires patience, my dear brothers, and struggle. جَنَّةً وَحَرِيرًا. Paradise and silk. وَدَانِيَةً عَلَيْهِمْ ظِلَالُهَا وَظُلِّلَتْ قُطُوفُهَا تَذْلِيلًا. And its shade and its trees are upon them, and its fruits are easy to go to reach, and they have palaces of gold, and they have everything they ever wish for, and they have servants who would come round to them with golden brass, with golden plates and golden cups, giving them grapes and fruit and water and drink. And وَيُسْقَوْنَ فِيهَا كَأْسًا كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا كَأْسًا جَبِيلًا عَيْنًا فِيهَا تُسَمَّى سَلْسَبِيلًا. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them water from a fountain which is so beautiful and tasty, they have never tasted anything like it before, from a fountain called سَلْسَبِيلًا. نعم. Jannah. Jannatun arduha as-samawati wal-ard. As great and as far as the heavens and earth, as the sky and earth. And they also sacrificed their lives. This is my last story, my dear brothers and sisters. This is a story which shocked me, wallahi al-azim. And it is a story that existed in about the 10th century. In the Islamic era. In that time, Muslims were attacking, enemies of Islam who were ruthless, were attacking the Muslims in a place called Ar-Raqqa in Iraq. And they had invaded the homes and raped the women and stole their children and killed the old men. This is in history. Because they said, our Lord is Allah. After doing so, there was a man at that time who existed. He was a great scholar and a great leader in battles. His only cause and motive was to defend the Muslims wherever they may be, wherever they were killed or oppressed. His name was Abu Qudama. This man, Abu Qudama, was once, and he was very courageous, he was once sitting in the masjid, when a group of people came up to him and they said to him, Ya Abu Qudama, we have free time right now. Can you tell us of an amazing story that happened during your time? We want to hear the most unusual and surprising story ever to be heard. Can you entertain us, Ya Abu Qudama, and make us come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then Abu Qudama sat for a while and gathered them. When everyone was silent, like you are right now, he said to them, I recall one of the most shocking stories that ever happened. Until today, I don't know how to explain it. He said, one time I went to that place, Ar-Raqqa in Iraq. And I stood up in the mosques. And I went out to the city where there were young Muslims to recruit soldiers who are ready to defend the borders of Ar-Raqqa, to stand guard over there. And if the enemy attacks, to be strong enough to defend the women and the children. As Allah says in the Quran, what is wrong with you, O believers, that you do not go and fight in the cause of Allah when the weak and feeble people are calling out, O Allah, send people to save us. We are responsible for the weak ones. Whoever and wherever they may be. And so he began to recruit people. Only a few gathered with him. And so he began to ask for some wealth and money. After the day had ended, he rented a small apartment, a little place to stay in. He said, I went into this place and I stayed there. And then just after Isha, when I was praying my night prayer, I was about to pray my witr. When all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, everything is quiet. You can hear the crickets outside. When my door began to knock, I said, Subhanallah, nobody knows me here. I've just arrived yesterday and already my door is knocking. Yani someone's knocking at my door. He said, so I slowly went and opened the door. And in front of me there stood a woman. I could not see her face because she had covered all of her body, everything. And while she was covering her hand, she reached out her hand, and before she opened it, she asked, "Are you the man who was calling out for recruitment today? Were you the man who was gathering wealth in order to go and guard our borders and protect us?" He said, "Yes." "You were the one who was calling to jihad." He said, "Yes, I am the one." So she said, "Please open your arm, your hand." And he opened his hand and she dropped a piece of cloth which was wrapped up into his hand. And he said, "Take this. It is an amana. It is a trust." And she ran off. That's all she said. I wanted to ask her many other questions, but she had no reply. So I went inside and I opened that cloth and I found a piece of paper with something written on it and a thick lock of hair. I read the paper and the paper said, "Today you are calling out for recruitments to fight with you and protect the weak people. I am a woman and unable to fight. And I don't have enough wealth to give you. So my heart was struck with shock and sorrow when I did not find anything to give you. So I went home and cut a lock of my hair. And that is the one you see in this cloth. The only thing which I can give to the cause of this is my lock of hair. I ask you to please use it as your rein," yani the rope that would steer the horse, "so that maybe Allah will recognize this and know that I was fighting with you in that jihad." Even though taking a lock of a hair of a mu'min woman, giving it to a man, is not allowed in Islam, but her jihad spirit reached that stage, she couldn't stop herself. She said, "And tomorrow someone will come to you. He is a recruitment. See if he is worthy." And that is it. He said, "Subhanallah, what kind of a woman is this?" He said, "So I took the lock of hair and I did put it onto my reins. And I, the next morning I gathered the troops and we went out into the battlefield. When we reached the battlefield, yani the borders, we noticed that a group of army after a day began to make their way towards us. And so I got the army ready and I told them to stand guard. As we were about to move forward, I heard a voice from a far distance calling out, 'Ya Ammi Aba Qudama, Ya Ammi Aba Qudama, intadirni, wait for me, my uncle.' He looked back and he found a fierce warrior on his horse galloping fiercely towards him. And he had his face covered like this. As soon as this man approached him, Abu Qudama looked at him and said, 'How can I help you?' He said, 'Wait for me. Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, who has written for me to meet you and unite with you.' He said, 'Calm down. Calm down and take a bit of breath.' He said, 'You don't understand. I made a dua all my life to have this opportunity and I thought that you were going to beat me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that I was going to unite with you. Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah.' He said, 'Ask me, what do you want?' He said, 'I want to fight with you. I want to have part in this.' And then Abu Qudama said to him, 'Show me your face. I want to know who you are.' And then he reluctantly took the cloth off his face. And Abu Qudama said, and I looked at his face, and before me was the most beautiful face that I'd ever laid eyes on. The face of a young man, about 17 or 18 years of age. His face was like the full moon in its brightness. And I noticed that he was young. And I said, 'Son, what experience do you have? How can you come and fight with us?' 'No, you are not allowed to come and fight with us. You are too young. Return back.' And he said, 'But my mother came to you last night.' He said, 'Your mother?' He said, 'Yes, my mother.' I said, 'Who is